Okay, let's get to experiment design. Disclaimer, when I talk about experiment design, I only talk about how to do this from a coding side of view. How to design your actual experiment is something left to other people because I don't have enough knowledge about that myself. But yeah, let's start with it. So if you participate in an experiment, you should be familiar with the basic structure of it. So some stimulus shown in a multitude of similar equivalents in a random order, sometimes mixed with distractors. Each display of a stimulus, so the atomic thing you're going to see, is a trial, and often then experiments are split up into multiple blocks showing, for example, different versions of the stimuli. Or you have a block, simply have the blocks because you want to pause in between, or you have a practice block or something. So the general order is, there is an experiment that's what's returned by design.experiment. The experiment consists of blocks, every block consists of trials, and then the trials consist probably contain one or more stimuli. Okay, and to show this, let's look at the Simon task here. The Simon task simply, where the Simon effect is the finding that the difference in accuracy or reaction time between trials in which stimulus and response are on the same side and as trials, stimulus and response on the same time, then the response time is slower than for trials in which they are on opposite times, sides, I mean. All right, so in this task, we have to press left or right depending on the color of the stimulus was green or red. And then stimulus is shown either on the left or on the right side. And if the Simon effect is true, then if we have to press left and the stimulus was on the left side, the reaction time is shorter than if the stimulus was not on the same side as the button we pressed. So in the first block, we have to press left if the stimulus is red. So by pressing left. Oh wow, that's weird shuffling. And I'm pressing right, left, etc. And then we have another block where the opposite is the case, where we have to press left if the stimulus was green. Okay, so what do we have in this task where we have two mappings, left for green and left for red, with two where conditions each, so if the block is left or right, with two color conditions each, a green and a red block, with two trials each. So we just saw 16 different, we saw 16 trials. Two times two times two times two trials each. Okay. And how do we do this in experiment? Well, we use in experiment the design package. The design package contains classes describing experimental structure. So this hierarchy I told you between experiment, blocks, and trials. Also, the design package allows for in-between subject factors, which differ depending on the subject ID. So if you want to show different subjects, different kinds of trials, you're going to use this as in-between subject, as BVS, BWS factors. Note, however, that if you do this, your design depends a lot on that because you have to have a lot more trials for this to be statistically relevant, etc., etc. And everything you create with the design package can be exported to be used by other packages, including PsychoPy, because you can simply make a CSV out of this, and this you can use in PsychoPy, even in PsychoPy's builder interface. So it's maybe a nice idea to do this. And in the homework, because I don't want to test GUIs again, because testing visual stuff sucks, as we saw in two homeworks already, you only have to create an experiment using experiment's design package. Okay, in experiment, you have to specify the design before calling control.start, such that in the actual experiment, the only thing we're doing is looping over all blocks and trials. Okay, so in between the initialize and the start, we are creating here, and this is a dumbed down version of the Simon task. So we only have two conditions here for the blocks, one for green stimuli and one for red stimuli. And this is the factor for our block. And then inside these blocks, we only have the left and right conditions. So this is only a 2x2. We only have 2 times 2 conditions, so 4 conditions. So we have two blocks. For each of those two versions, we create a block, which has a name containing if it's red or green stimuli. And then we use the set factor method of an experiment block, where to set the factor that. What is the block here? Factor is simply a key value pair, which we can recover when using the when looping over the blocks and trials. And then inside of each block, we have two trials. And the trial is either, well, on the left or on the right side. So we set factor that the position here is either left or right. And then we add to this trial, we add the stimulus, well, either on the left or on the right side, depending on what we wanted to have here. Thus, we create the stimulus, we add the stimulus to our trial, we add the trial to a block, and we add the block to our experiment. And now we have an experiment that has blocks, that has trials, that has stimuli. And to run this, we have this really simple loop. We loop over all blocks, we loop over all trials inside the blocks, we loop over all stimuli, well, we don't loop here, but we simply show the one stimulus we have, and we wait. Now if we run this, we saw it didn't shuffle or anything. It just showed the four different conditions. Okay, so I already introduced factors here. So a factor is simply a key value pair that can be used to store information about a block or trial such that we can restore this information throughout the experiment to display custom things and lock conditions of blocks and trials. So we're doing the same thing here, just not in a loop. So we're creating the first block, block one, where we have a green color as factor. We had trials here. So we had the same trial two times. So if we're adding trials to a block, we can simply say how many copies of that we want to add. And then we have the second block where the factor says it's red. And then in the actual experiment, we can use, for example, block.getFactorColor, which will tell me what we are presenting. So if I'm running this, it will show green circles and now red circles. This part normally would set it algorithmically in a loop, which is basically what I did earlier. So we have this loop, we're looping over the colors, and inside that we're looping over the grays. All right. So now I want to show you this in the debugger such that we can actually look at it. And it's really nice that I introduced the debugger earlier, so I can just go through here. So I click debug, and I have a breakpoint here. So now the initialization is going to happen, which opens this window. But now it's stuck here because it's stuck between the initialize and start block, and now the focus is given to the debugger. So now we can look at the exp. Now we see this is an experiment, which contains, for example, a clock, contains an events file, keyboard, mouse object, etc., etc., a screen object. And also it contains, for example, a list of block factor names. And one factor name is color because we set this here as a factor. So we could loop over that, for example. And now the experiment contains block. So inside the experiment, there are two blocks. And the block already gives me a nice representation of what's in there. So it says block 0, green stimuli, block factors, color equals green, two trials with these trial IDs and these trial factors. So if we look at it, we see that inside this block, we have the factor dict again. So color equals green was the factor we set here. And then it has more attributes and it also has the trial. So each block has these trials and each trial then also has a factor dict because we added this here, the position. So now we have the position here, we have the factor names. And each trial then has the stimuli, and stimuli are this. And we could also like now work on this. We could say result, exp.blocks0, dot summary equals something else or something. So we can set this somewhere in the code. Okay. So we could also shuffle the blocks, yes. So and there we have the method shuffle trials, which has, for example, also an argument of the maximum repetitions, which is really nice. And this is, so shuffling is actually not as trivial as you may think. Because if you have shuffling conditions, like for example, you don't want to show the same condition for a block several times in a row, then what you naively would do is you would, for example, shuffle and shuffle and shuffle and shuffle until the condition is met. So you have a while loop where you shuffle until while the condition is not met. That, for example, you have never have more than two conditions in a row. But this has a theoretical complexity of O of infinity. And you shouldn't do this, and there are smarter ways. I wrote a bit about this here in the appendix, but generally, if there's, for example, a function given by experiment, you can assume that this is pretty nicely implemented. Okay, And just like I said, you can use the design package alone and export the design for other libraries, including PsychoPy. So we're creating simply here a design.experiment with a block, or rather with two blocks, but the second block is an exact copy of the first block. And inside each block, we have three different conditions, and each of them we insert five times. And then we have two blocks. So we have 30 different trials in here. 5 × 3 × 2. And then inside these blocks, we shuffle the trials. So we only have these two blocks here to make sure that in the first half of the experiment, every condition is shown precisely once, or rather 5 times here, and in the second half two, such that they don't mix up too badly, that you only see the A and B conditions in the first half and C conditions in the second half. This is also one way of making sure that the order is correct. And then we can simply call exp.saveDesign. Now if we look at this, now we added the design here. However, if we look at it, we see that this is a commented CSV, which we cannot look at nicely in this CSV viewer. But of course, we have pandas as a nice CSV viewer, where we can simply say there's a comment sign and that's hash. If we now look at this, we see this is what experiment automatically created. So it adds block count, block ID, trial count, trial ID, and the condition here. And we see that the conditions are shuffled. And we see, for example, that we have C 2 times in a row here. And if we told it here, max repetition tickets 1, then this wouldn't happen, that we have C 2 times in a row. And yes, we see that this here, it has 15 elements in the first block, with 5 times C, 5 times B, 5 times A in the first block. And then the second block starts at the 15th element and goes into the 30th element. And this is what you have to do also in the homework. And this is what you could import in PsychoPy also, for example, even inside PsychoPy's builder. Okay, then I want to show you that we can also set these between subject factors in experiment. And in doing so, I also want to show you the study where I used that. And the study is one that I did as a Hebe a couple of years ago. And it's a linguistic experiment in which reading times are measured, as well as the controlled questions asked to test if the participant actually read the sentences. You also analyzed the results of this in an earlier session. However, there the results were anonymized and were simply were messed up on purpose. Okay, it's this paper by Mignolio, which is not out yet. So the study tests if German native speakers interpret the conditional "falls" different than the conditional "wenn," with the hypothesis that "wenn" is interpreted as biconditional, meaning that if you afterwards hear that P and not Q, for example, so the antecedent and the consequent, and the antecedent is true and the consequent is not true, then you interpret that as, that's not what I think. However, a "falls" is interpreted as material implication, for which it can be the case that P and not Q. And it assumes that if that is the case, that you're thinking, this is wrong, that the response time for the sentence is longer, the reading time. So it assumes that if the sentence doesn't correspond to a valid formula and propositional logic, you have longer reading times. And which conditions are shown for which sentences is different from subject to subject. So this is our between subject factor. So I'm going to show you a downscaled version, which simply has a 2x2 design. So for every trial, you either get the "falls" or "wenn" condition. And then there's also either the P and Q, the "gab gab," or the P and not Q, "gab gab nicht" condition. So this is the file I'm using here. So this is, again, it's not the entire file, so obviously the study was longer, but I'm only showing 4 conditions and 3 sentences from this study. Okay, and so this is how to read it nicely in pandas. And then if we look at it, we have 7 sentences, and here we have the "wenn" or the "falls," and here then we have the "gab gab," so the P and Q, or the, actually that's not P and Q. And then we have 4 conditions, because we have either "wenn" P and Q, "falls" P and Q, "wenn" not P and Q, "falls" not P and Q. Now if the findings of the study will turn out true, then this will have the longest reading time. And now actually, normally we should show some sentences of this condition to a subject, and some sentences of the other condition to the same subject. But here we're just going to assume that we're showing different conditions to different subjects. And how do we do this in experiment? Well, here's the code. So first of all, we have our Lord, we set some stuff up, and then we use the conditions here. And actually, let me show you that in the debugger as well. So we start by adding all the blocks. So we make all conditions for all subjects, even though we don't want this in the end, but I'm doing it in a way where I'm simply deleting the non-fitting blocks afterwards. So at first, every subject is gonna have, so every time I run this, there's gonna be all the blocks. Only afterwards, we're gonna delete the ones that don't fit. So if you look here at conditions, this is simply grouped by the CSV I showed you, grouped by conditions. So we have this CS1 condition, 2, 3, 4. Okay, and if we view the separate conditions as data frame, we see that we have 3 sentences per condition. So we always have condition 1 here, and for the second one, we always have condition 2, etc. Okay, and then what we're doing is where we're making a block for each of the respective conditions, and inside the conditions, we're setting the factor for the block, such that we know which condition it is. And then we're simply going over the lines here and adding every sentence as stimulus. And then we're adding this to the trials to the block, and then the blocks to the experiment. Okay. And then we tell the experiment that there's this between subjects factor, that there are 2 of these. The files when condition, which can have the values when or files, and the gab-gab condition, which can have the values gab-gab or gab-nicht-gab. Okay, and now, depending on the subject number, it's going to select either this or this, and either this or this. So if the subject number modulo 4 is 0 or 1, then I'm going to take the first of both. If the subject number modulo, if the subject number modulo 4 equals 2, then I'm going to take this and this. If it's 3, I'm going to take this and this, and if it's 4, I'm going to take this and this. Or rather, 0, 1, 2, 3. Okay, so now we could also shuffle, by the way, this that it doesn't take 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, the condition 1, 2, 3, 4, but shuffles this. But generally, we see here that now, like I said, we have these 4 blocks, and inside each of those blocks, we have the 3 tiles, and inside these, we have the 7 sentences as stimuli. And we also see that we have the between factor names, which are the files when condition and the gab-gab condition. And there we have the possibilities, which I showed you here. And we don't randomize the between subjects factor, such that now we know that if we have a subject number 1, it will get this, this. Okay. But so far, because we didn't go to the control.start part yet, there is no subject number. So only afterwards here, so subject number, let's make it 9. And for subject number 9, we should have the first condition each. So let's look at this. Let's look at exp.getPermutedBVS BWS factor condition, and we see that this is the when condition. Oh, actually, it's not. So I messed something. No, it is. Yes, the files when condition is when, which is the first one, and the gab-gab condition is gab-gab. And if we had another number, we would have other things here. What I'm simply doing here is, depending on what the respective values were, I'm simply deleting the non-appropriate conditions. Okay, so I'm simply having this to-delete set, which simply now contains condition 3, 5, and 6, which we want to delete. And then I'm simply going over the blocks and removing the respective blocks. So now, afterwards, my experiment only has the one block which I want to have for this one, for this person. So now only gets sentences of condition 1. Like I said, normally you wouldn't show one subject all the conditions of this and the other subject all the conditions of this, but you would shuffle that you would give respective sentences, that you would force this and the sentences, you get this condition, and for this and this sentence, you get this one. But like I said, dumb down. So now I'm showing the subject that it will get these conditions here. And then what I'm doing is I'm simply looping over all the blocks, I'm looping over the trials, and I'm showing the stimuli. So let's do that here. And we're seeing this is the condition they're getting. All right. as much for PsychoPy's design pack, for Experiment's design package. Now let's look at PsychoPy, which means I can use my good microphone again. PsychoPy has two classes for experimental design, the trial handler and the stair handler. And what we do in PsychoPy is we also loop over everything that the trial handler gives me, so I can simply loop over the respective handler. The trial handler is the easy one, where it simply chooses a trial sequentially or random out of a list of predefined conditions. And the stair handler is a nice thing. It uses this adaptive staircase where for each trial the next condition is based on the participant's response, which is a nice thing, which I don't know how to implement in Experiment actually. So the trial handler, let's look at an easy experiment. So I have to change to PsychoPy again, and then we can look at this code. So what we're doing here is, well, we know this stuff. We create a window, we create the stimuli, we add global keys. And then what I simply want to do is I want to show the grating stimulus at different positions on the screen. So what I do, I create this handler, data.trialHandler, with the list here for the conditions basically. This here is the number of repetitions. I only want one, and I simply want to show them sequential, so not in any random order. And then what I'm doing inside the experiment is the same as before. As an experiment, I'm simply looping for trial and handler, and then I can get trial here, which is only, well, I only have a list of integers, so I'm getting back an integer, and I can use this to set the position. And if I'm running this here, I'm simply looping over the positions here, so really easy. Make sure in general that you use, that if you use PsychoPy and experiments, to adhere to the order of things I'm showing you here. So at first you create the window and the handler, which we do here. Then afterwards we prepare all the stimuli. We don't do this inside the experiment because this will mess up timing. Then set up everything else that can be set up, for example, the global keys here, before the actual procedure. And then inside the procedure, you want to do as little as possible. You want to keep the actual procedure as short as possible as to not mess up timing. Okay, and then after the trial handler, we also look at an example for the stair handler. And this is a more complex example, which I stole from the PsychoPy tutorial here for the coding interface. And this is an experiment for the just noticeable difference in orientation using the staircase method. So this experiment wants to figure out what the minimal difference in orientation is that you notice. So it's going to show two grating stimuli, and one of them is not going to be precisely vertical. Okay, and depending on your response, it decides how much more extreme the next one is going to be. So if you couldn't decide which one is the vertical one, so it's going to show you two stimuli, one of them is exactly vertical, the other isn't. And if you recognize the vertical one, the next non-vertical one it's going to show you is going to be a bit more vertical, until you cannot differentiate them anymore. And if you cannot differentiate, if you decided wrong, then the vertical one, so the non-vertical one, I mean, is going to be more non-vertical. Okay? Not that I dumped the experiment down a bit, and I still didn't use any data logging, because we didn't do analysis. And also, how we do analysis here is not the correct way to do this. I'm just showing you some mean. So in time critical, and also in time critical experiments, you wouldn't use core dot weight, which we use here. But I'm going to talk about timing in a second anyway. So what do we do? We have the reference orientation, which is zero. It doesn't need to be zero. We're going to see a way of how to not have it zero later. And then we create this staircase handler. Okay, so we start with a value of 20 degrees. The step type here is decibel, which simply means we're not decreasing the sizes proportionally, but using a power ratio. And then what we're doing is, so we begin with an increment of 20 degrees and home in on the 80% threshold value, and then We are, so if every time the subject gets a wrong answer, we step down. And also, if they get three right answers in a row, because it's chance if we take the right one or not. And yeah, the step size will also decrease every two rehearsals anyway. And we're starting with an 8 dB step, which is large, and we're going down to a 1 dB step, which is rather small, with one trial each. And doing this, we finish after 50 trials. Why we know that's 50, I can't tell you right now. But yeah, so we create first all the window and the stimuli. We display some kind of instructions. So we have this, make the fixation draw. We flip the screen to show anything. We wait, so this simply shows the instructions. And then we're looping. And this is the actual loop of the experiment, which is rather long, I think. But what we're doing here is, well, on which side we're showing the target, so the correct one is random. And then we have the foil and the target, which we show in the respective locations. And for the foil, then we set the orientation using this reference orientation, which starts to be 0 here, plus the increments. So the reference orientation is 0 degrees, could be 90 as well, or something else. And if we want to have a horizontal stimuli, plus, and then the increment, which is at first these 20 degrees and decreases or increases using, well, depending on what the user does, depending on what we set here. We draw both, we wait, which is imprecise. I'm going to talk about that in a second. And then we're waiting for a response. So we use event.wait keys, and then we're analyzing what the user pressed. And these are the correct and incorrect ones. And if the response, so if the user presses escape, we're exiting. And if the response was correct, so we have to add this data to the staircase such that it can calculate the next level. So this response is either true or false, basically. It's either one or negative one. And if it's true, then the condition, so we're going to follow the condition for when it's true. So we're going to go up every one trial. And if it's false, we're going to go up every three trials. Or we're going to go down, respectively, what I said before. And then we wait 1 second and let the next trial show. And then afterwards, we give some analyzations. So this is simply how we get from the staircase, we get the reversal intensities. And then we take the mean of it. And we show this to the subject. So now let's run this. That was the left one. Again, the left one. So the right one got closer. I think that was the left one again. Now I really can't tell. I really can't tell. Left one, maybe? Left one. I really can't tell. So yeah, the worse we are, the higher the difference is gonna come. Am I correct all the time? Why is the difference so low? God, make an obvious one. That was left. That was right. So 2.6. Okay, whatever you say. So yeah, this is how to use a staircase, which is a nice thing which PsychoPy can do. But you have to specify precisely how you want it to be and justify it if you make an experiment like this.